Hello, this is Lisa DeLay. I'm going to be reading two extended excerpts from Rex the Boy King. I hope you're interested and enjoy the story and support our project. Rex the Boy King by Lisa DeLay, illustrated by Gabrielle DeLay and Timothy DeLay. There was a boy, a very strange, enchanted boy. They say he wandered very far over land and sea. A little shy and sad of eye, but very wise was he. And then one day, a magic day, he passed my way, and while he spoke of many things, fools and kings, this he said to me: "The greatest thing you'll ever learn is just to love and to be loved in return." Eden Ives. Rex was a boy who always felt like a king. He had no reason to think this because he was from a common family and lived in a common house and had a common life. But deep down inside, he felt like royalty in exile. Rex had the kind of imagination that took him on adventures of the mind. In his daydreams or night dreams, he could slide through time and space and do spectacular things in spectacular places. But all this happened as if he was remembering something or doing something over again and not just dreaming about it for the first time. This happened, he felt, because he had once been a king, or maybe a prince, and had traveled to many places in the universe and had come to Earth by surprise or accident, and somehow lost his memory when he was very young. His parents had adopted Rex as a baby after wanting a child of their own for a long time. They loved his imagination and enjoyed the stories he told them. His mother would often look at him out of the corner of her eye as he played or pretended, as he sketched or built things, or as he imagined and daydreamed. She did not directly stare so as not to dissuade or embarrass him. His mother kept a quiet watch on him and wondered about him. He was strange, sometimes sad, but he was very good and kind. He was like a light in a dark place. Each day, Rex was full of wonder and immense and innocent wisdom that made him see the world unlike most people do. Seeing that Rex was active and restless, his father built Rex a treehouse and a go-kart from wagon parts and a tire swing, and a telescope to make it easier for Rex to play, imagine, and have adventures of his own making. His father encouraged him to enjoy the world around him, and Rex did just that. It was on faith, in fact, that his parents settled into thinking of Rex as uncommon, and in this environment, Rex flourished and made his way through childhood. Day by day, he got more used to the world and used to himself in it. When Rex would be deep into a daydream, or at night when he fell asleep, he had many adventures and went to many places. Rex met many interesting creatures, and all different sorts of people, too. In his musings, he had special powers, sometimes like flying, or being very strong, or being indestructible. Sometimes he could jump very high, or he was able to hold his breath for a very, very long time and swim underwater. But of course, none of it really seemed like dreaming or thinking at all to him. It seemed like something that actually happened. It felt like his mind was like a teleport that could take him anywhere. And when it was time to leave the place he was, he would wake up or be pulled out of his daydream. Once, Rex woke up one morning from a dream and told the most amazing story. Excerpt 2. A red fox comes out of the green and over to the stream on the other side. It is holding a small rabbit in its mouth. I think it must have just caught the rabbit for a meal. It notices me, and I stay very still and keep watching. Then the fox puts the rabbit down and starts taking a drink. The rabbit, who hasn't moved at all, stretches its legs, shakes its ears, and nibbles at some plants near the water. I say, "Oh!" out loud in surprise. The fox looks up and speaks to me. I hear him with my mind's ears. "What surprises you?" it says. "I'm not sure," I say, because I can't find the words. Then I feel embarrassed to be speaking with a fox. "Not every fox eats rabbits," it says. "Yes, I know that," I say, trying to seem experienced. "But I really don't know what to say or do, and I feel foolish." "I used to eat everything I could catch," said the fox. I don't say anything this time, and then it continues. "I was very wild, and when a noise would surprise me, I would run and hide in the thickets near the gorge. I hoped no one would find me. I was scared, and often cold and lonely." I nod, hoping he'll continue. The fox looks around, and the rabbit keeps eating. Then the fox looks me right in the eye and says to my mind's ears, "One day, I came suddenly upon a creature as I rounded a tree. I did not know it was a rabbit at the time. We surprised each other, and the rabbit, who was used to running away, startled and dashed off, and I was startled too, so I ran for my life. But foxes eat rabbits, don't they? I asked. Yes, normally. I wasn't hungry or hunting at the time. I ran because I was wild, and I often scared by others, because I was always alone, says the fox. The fox looks at the rabbit and then back at me. When I stopped running, I crouched low in a thicket and hid my eyes with my paws. My heart was beating very fast, and I was cold and shaking. I could hear myself breathing very quickly. But after a few minutes, I opened my eyes, and I realized I was actually listening to the rabbit breathing. We had hid in the same spot. We were both scared and hiding. Then what happened, I asked. I realized that because we were both afraid, I had nothing to be scared of. This thought calmed me down. So I stayed in the same spot for a long time, and I waited for the rabbit to calm down too. How strange, I say. Yes, all things we don't understand are strange at first. Why would the rabbit stay with you? You have sharp teeth, perfect for eating rabbits. She was very afraid, but she saw me hiding, and she knew I was afraid too. She stopped running long enough for something new to happen. Something new? Something special, something unlike the ordinary cruelties that happen to creatures in the wild, says the fox. I knew that if we were both afraid, we could both be afraid together, and then we wouldn't have to be scared or alone anymore. Somehow she knew that too. The rabbit twitches her nose, and the fox lowers his head to take another drink, but then looks up the hillside behind him. Something following you, I ask? I hear something. We both do. If a human finds me, he will think I'm mad. If I appear to be a fox who doesn't eat rabbits, people will think I have a brain sickness or rabies. People will kill what they fear. Hunters may want my pelt as a trophy or maybe a hat. It's not safe for us here. Please, before you go, tell me what happened next, I ask. The fox looks at the rabbit, who has sat straight up, started twisting its ears. Then the fox looks at me again. I will say this. Only love can tame you. Anything else that tames you is only a kind of pen. A pen, I ask? A cage, a way to control another. It's the stuff of power or force, nothing more. Nothing noble, says the fox. You wanted to tame the rabbit? I ask. I knew nothing of taming or being tamed, but I was patient. This time, because I had always been wild and I had to fend for myself. Because of that, I knew no one, and no one knew me. I loved no one, and no one loved me. I was sick in my heart because of that. Is she tame now? That is for the rabbit to say. But here is how she came to not be afraid of me any longer. When I was hiding in the thicket, I waited. Then I moved closer and closer to her, little by little, very slowly, barely noticeably, with my paws over my eyes, until she was quite used to me and much less afraid. As the fox says this, he moves closer to the rabbit. I was patient because I knew she would hurt no one, and I didn't want her to be scared any more. The waiting took so long that I fell asleep, and when I woke up, the rabbit was cuddled in my paws, sleeping too. And then you were friends, I ask? Not just friends, rescuers. We needed each other. I feel my face get hot, and I realize the fox is a creature unlike me. It is wild but wise. It is good but dangerous, too. It is always on the run. It will not stay near me for much longer. You don't have to run away from me, I say, wanting to be with the fox and travel with the pair of them. The fox and the rabbit look at me, unblinking. I step toward them, and in one instant, the fox picks up the rabbit carefully in its mouth and leaps away into the brush and out of sight. My breath gets stuck in my throat, and my throat gets a lump in it. After I run after them, I trip and fall on a stone. Everything goes black. When I wake up, the forest is darkened and full of night sounds. A slice of moon shines through the trees. I feel cold and wet with mud, so I crawl to drier ground and look around. I look up into a tall pine. I see a dark shape on one of the branches. It's an owl, and it makes a hoo sound, like it's calling me. What do you want? I call to the owl. What do you want? The owl asks me. I need to get home. I'm cold and alone, I say to the owl. Where is home? Says the owl. I don't know, I say to him. Then I cannot help you, he says. At that, he lifts off his perch and flies soundlessly towards me. His huge wings spread out, their fingers, their feathers, as he swoops past me, disappearing into the forest darkness. My head feels heavy with sleep and sadness, and I find an opening in a tree trunk to be my bed. I pick fern fronds to use as a covering. My stomach feels sick and my eyes want to close, and I curl up in my ferns and shut my eyes to sleep. "Then you woke up?" asked his father. "Oh no, I went back to the meadow again." That ends excerpt 2.